All right, good morning, everyone. My name is Sean, and welcome to PEMANDU Associates' second brown bag series. With here today, we have Tan Sri Dr. Tony Fernandes, who will be sharing with us his AirAsia transformation journey. Before we begin, allow me to run through some of our Zoom housekeeping etiquette for the virtual brown bag series. You may be aware by now that all microphones have been set to mute. This is to ensure that the event will be smooth sailing and to avoid minimal interruptions as much as possible. So we'll be allowing participants to proceed with the Q&A session. Please click on the Q&A icon located at the bottom of your screen. Type your questions where indicated, and our moderator will prompt you or ask the questions on your behalf. There will also be an open floor Q&A session where you can type, "I have a question," on the chat box, click send, and our moderator will cue you to unmute your mic during your time. This is the schedule for today's brown bag session. We are here now at the housekeeping etiquette. After this, I will be having Dato' Sri Idris Jala to provide his opening remarks. And we will have the moderated session with Tan Sri Tony Fernandes, followed by the open floor Q&A at 11:15 a.m. At 11:55, Dato' Sri Idris Jala will be providing his closing remarks, and we are expected to wrap up by 12 p.m. noon. Without further ado, allow me to invite Dato' Sri Idris Jala, Chairman and President of PEMANDU Associates, to give his opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sean. Welcome to our brown bag session. I want to thank Tony, my good friend Tony, for agreeing to come and share his very successful and incredible story of making some businesses that look impossible, making them possible. And Tony is a very, very robust competitor. I've known that, and it's a very, very good guy, very tough competitor, but he's an extremely astute businessman and a big man in entrepreneurship. And so there's a lot of things that we can learn from him. You know, so a lot of people in my team, Tony, they wanted you to come, and they really said, we must get Tony. If Tony doesn't come, then it's not complete. And particularly at this time when we have the COVID-19 crisis, and people are really looking for ways and means to do it. And you guys are very hard hit in the travel industry as well as hospitality. So your thinking and your learning is very, very useful as people navigate through this. Tony does not need any introduction. Everybody in Malaysia knows Tony. If you don't know Tony, it's like you don't know the Great Wall of China exists in China. So I don't need to introduce him to you. So we go straight into it. Thank you very much for gracing the occasion, Tony.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Idris, for inviting me. And thank you for reminding me what great music is.
Hi, everyone. A very good morning to all. And thank you again for joining us today. My name is Fizman, and we are very honored to be hosting our guest speaker for today, the maverick himself, Tan Sri Dr. Tony Fernandes. As Idris said earlier, Tan Sri Fernandes needs no introduction. Simply put, he has done it all. As the co-founder and CEO, he took over AirAsia for just ₱1 at the time when the company had more than ₱40 million in debt and transformed it into the behemoth that it is today. Moving beyond the airline industry, he is now taking AirAsia into new terrains, venturing into the digital business, including in e-commerce, logistics, food and food delivery, and even finance. Aside from that, Tan Sri is also the owner of Queen's Park Rangers FC and most recently launched a podcast called Talks with Tony. In the midst of all of that, Tan Sri has graciously made time for us on Saturday morning. For information, Tan Sri, we have an amazing setup today with over 228 people joining us, all eager to hear from you. So how are you today, Tan Sri?
I'm great. Call me Tony. For Tan Sri. Yeah, great to be here. Thanks for having me, and looking forward to it. Anything sure. Organized by PEMANDU and Idris is always going to be enjoyable, for sure.
Sure. If I may, Tony, I'd like to rewind the clock just a little bit and look at the journey that you've had leading up to AirAsia, and obviously we'll move from there. You started your career in Virgin Group, rose up the ranks, joined Warner Music. What was that journey like for you, and did it play a part in influencing you to start an airline?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, it kind of sounds like a fairy tale, but, you know, my mother was in Tupperware, and she used to fly all over Malaysia selling Tupperware. And the big highlight of my life at that period was going to the airport to pick her up. And it was Subang Airport, which I still think is the greatest airport in Malaysia. Far better than KLIA. and leaps 20,000 leagues above KLIA 2. But I used to go to Subang Airport. I was a bit of a plane spotter. We'd turn up very early at the airport, me and my dad, put 10 cents into the viewing camera and watched a few planes. And in those days, you could see people coming off the plane. You could track them all the way to the baggage hall and actually even watch people getting their bags. So I always wanted to be in the airline business. I told my dad cheekily, maybe I was 6 years old, that you know, I wanted to start an airline, which of course he laughed. So that was always in my mind. But obviously music was a massive passion to me. I was a musician. I bought my first LP, The Supremes, when I was about 5 years old, actually, from Wells Supermarket. And so I've always been into music. So that was my first port of call at Virgin and Warner, as you've just mentioned. And then, you know, I had a great 12 years in the music industry. But when I was at boarding school, I used to visit Heathrow Airport. So it was always in my mind. Mm-hmm. And when the point came to leave the music industry, you know, sitting in a pub in Hampstead, I saw Stelios of EasyJet. And I thought, this is my calling. I want to go start an airline, as you do. You just decide I'm going to start an airline. Now, there's a very fine line between brilliance and stupidity. But as I always say, you only live once. And if you don't try, you don't know. If you fail, you fail. But if you don't, you don't want to sit there at 55. And I've passed that 55 now, so I have to change that to 60 and say, I wish I'd done that. It's too late.
Yeah, but that's really interesting because a lot of people, when they think about the aviation industry, especially when they're young, right, they say, oh, I want to be a pilot or an aircraft engineer. Yeah. But really, but your story of AirAsia is an amazing one because, like I said earlier, you and Datuk Kamaruddin took over this company for just one ringgit, which I'm guessing you split like 50-50. And then...
Yeah, 51. when I persuaded Kamaruddin to join us, and it didn't take very long to persuade him, yep. That's the beauty of our relationship. Yeah. I, you know, he said, okay, I'll join 50-50. And I said, no, I want 51. It's my idea.
So, but at the time, the company had more than 40 million ringgit of debt. And within a year, it had broken even, cleared all this debt. By the next year, made a profit. Can you take us through what you did throughout that two-year period to achieve this? Because I'm sure it wasn't an easy journey throughout that 2 years long.
No. Hasn't been easy for the 19 years, just to let you know. But nothing has come easy for us. Kamari will always say to us, and Rosman, nothing comes easy for us. That's why we value it so much. And that's probably why we have been so efficient and really kind of a hard competitor, because we've really come from the bottom. You know, what did we do? The first thing is the business model. We knew. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to know that everyone wants to fly for 50% less. So that was the kind of principle, you know. We're going to have a business model that people like. Then it was just the four letters that I think even Idris uses a lot. KISS, keep it simple, stupid. When I came from the music business, I looked at airlines and I thought, why is it so complicated? Why do they make things so complicated? You know, there was so much extra cost. So we took away a lot of cost. We simplified the business model. I'm sure you're going to ask me about it at some stage, but we really built an amazing culture, which some people have been questioning. And we put all those little ingredients together and went out and built this amazing airline. And I come from a school of cash flow. And as I go into the digital world, I hope you ask me about it. It is so ironic. I came to the airline business and no one made money. I now go into the digital business and no one makes money either. And no one looks at cash flow. I'm just an old-fashioned businessman. If there's one lesson you're going to take away from me, and this, accountants can make P&Ls look like anything they want to. It's really, the bottom line is, how much cash do you have in a bank? And so that's how I've always run the company. How much cash do we have? And even through COVID, we've survived 18 months with no flying, just managing cash very, very well. So, you know, the second lesson, if there is a second lesson, is always look at cash flow. Always focus on your cash and always make sure you prepare for that rainy day. Now, I never believed we would not fly for 18 months, but we were able to survive up to this point.
Yeah.
So in short, change your business model, motivate the staff, bring down cost, and bring down cost meant the staff understanding the business model so well that they could contribute to reducing costs. Many companies fail that. Many companies don't let their staff know what their mission is all about. My 200 staff at that time knew the mission. It was like a religion. And then, you know, we marketed like anything.
Yeah. But so Tan Sri, your venture into this industry came at a time when the industry as a whole was facing slowing demand, right? It was in the aftermath of the 9/11 crisis, but you saw it as an opportunity. There was a lot of decline in leasing costs. There was a pool of readily available staff due to layoffs. Obviously, these were factors that worked in your favor. But I guess if someone were to look at it in a different way, it would say, this might not be the best industry to come in at this time, right? But you come in and you say, you have this business model. So what exactly did you see that you think, okay, maybe this is a smart move at this moment in time?
Yeah. Well, number one, I wanted to own my own company. I always felt corporations treated people badly. So I wanted to own a business. I wanted a business to be impactful. I am pretty much a capitalist, but what would you call a caring capitalist? I believe that the capitalist model is the only economic model that works, but you can still take care of people. You can still have a meritocracy. You can still allow someone who didn't have an education to be a pilot or a CEO. So that was my dream. That was one. And then two, one number hit at me was that only 6% of Malaysians flew. Mm-hmm. So that's what I said at the beginning of this call, that you have to have something that people want, right? Who doesn't want to fly? Who doesn't want to travel, mm-hmm. right? Even now with COVID, everyone wants to travel still. And so those were the two things. Now, 9/11 happened after we bought the airline. Okay, me and Kamruddin and Aziz and Dr. Parman signed a deal 3 days before 9/11. 9/11 was, in a strange way, a blessing in disguise, and it's kind of repeated itself again with COVID, that we've been able to go and build this amazing digital company, which only now a few people are beginning to see has a lot of potential. So we built the business first on the principle that only a few people flew, but we knew everyone else wanted to fly. And then the bonus, and you have to have luck, the bonus of 9/11 and lease planes came down, et cetera, enabled us to go and build a very strong model. And no one took it seriously, right? Malaysian Airlines, I think they must have laughed at who is this joker from the music business. And by the time they did take it seriously, we were too big. We did have a little bit of an advantage there.
Yeah. So, Tony, I just like to go back to what you said about people building that strong culture. But you said early on that you had 254 terrified staff, or all-stars, as you call them, right?
Yeah.
What was your principle in building this team? And has that approach changed between when you first started and now that it has grown to the size that it is today?
That never changed. Never changed. What did I do? My management is 50% walk around management. You know, I knew every single staff. My management is getting to do every single job in that company, right? From changing a wheel to learning how to fly a plane in the simulator, not the real thing, to being a cabin crew. My job is transparency amongst all staff. So I made all staff get to know each other. We used to have weekly staff sessions after the last plane came in, over 200 people in Pan Pacific Hotel. Transparency, open communication, flatness of structure, and a sense of team is what got us to where we are and is what has enabled us to survive COVID up to this point.
So you mentioned that you have this flat structure within the company. I'm sure that's very difficult to maintain, especially now that it has become the size that it is today. How do you maintain such a structure in such in an evolving company like yours?
Yeah, I think social media, while it has its negatives, but social media within the company enables you to communicate with 24,000 staff. Not as effectively as meeting everyone face to face, but it's not a bad second choice. And I'm not a believer in email. I hate email. I think email is very, very old-fashioned. It's bureaucratic. It slows down decision-making. It covers your ass sometimes. You know, people copy you, thousands of people, so that they're covering their ass. So we're much more into live communication and messaging. So we built our own messaging system called Chili, and decisions are made virtually on the spot. So it is harder. I mean, you know, I can't say I know every single staff anymore like I used to, but I would know a large, large proportion of our working staff through Workplace, which is a Facebook product, and social media. Instant messaging.
Instant messaging. Okay. Yeah. So, Tony, I'd like to go a bit into, just go a little bit back to your early career. Just wanted to know, what was an advice that you got early on that has shaped the way you approach things now?
Well, I didn't listen to it all the time, but it is the best advice I got, you know, from my former boss, Stephen Shrimpton, who was the president of Warner Music. And that was basically patience, focus, and don't try to build Rome in a day. It takes time. You know, I've always been in a rush. Yeah. Now, focus sometimes, you know, I can't say I've been the most focused trying to run an airline Formula One team and QPR, and hence you fail. So focus is still really important. But within AirAsia, we've been laser focused.
Right. And does that apply to a lot of businesses today? Is that something that you think focus, patience, and they'll try to build Rome in a day? Is that something you think applies?
Yeah, really? Correct. I mean, I always say with AirAsia, I used to say, you know, let's be a Kampong champion first before we want to take on the world. I always see many companies say, oh, they're going to be world beaters, they're going to do this, they're going to do that. Not to say we didn't want to, but we always said, build slowly, build carefully, build a structure. So when you're building a house, you know, the most important thing is the structure, right?
Yeah.
Is the piling, is making a house nice after that is very easy. So I always say, get the principles right, get the focus right, et cetera. So, you know, we're doing a digital business, you know, the Singapore Press, which love to run me down. Well, many do actually, but, you know, so say, oh yeah, very slow started food delivery, et cetera. I said, we've only been doing it for 3 months. You know, it took us 7 years to get a flight between KL and Singapore, which Idris had something to do with that last few years. And, when we got there, we became number one in the KL Singapore route after 2 years. So, you know, this is not a marathon. Culture is not a marathon. Safety is not a marathon. But as long as you're willing to learn and to keep improving and to realize you're not the best, and that you can as quick as you go up, you can come down much quicker, then you'll improve.
Yeah. So I want to get to the digital business, but I'm going to hold that for a bit. So you said that the airline industry, you've been in it for about 19 years, right, Tan Sri? So 19 years, and I'm sure...
In fact, on September the 9th, September the 8th, actually, sorry, Kamaruddin, me, Dr. Pamin, and Aziz would have signed... That was the signing date. September 8th, 2001.
September 8th.
Was when we signed... to take over AirAsia. It's a cool story. You know, the night before, one of the shareholders tried to kill the deal. Yeah. I couldn't sleep. We turned up at the RB HighCom, and there was an emergency board meeting because one of the shareholders was trying to stop the deal. And then they came out and said, no, they've approved the deal. And then we signed. And then we had to pay 2 ringgit. and me and Cameroon didn't have 2 ringgit with us. So we had to pay 1 ringgit for the airline and 1 ringgit for the debt. Cameroon was smart enough to ask for the debt to be a convertible loan.
Right.
And so we had to borrow the 2 ringgit from the DRB executive director. Sorry, I interrupted you. It would be 20 years in a few days' time.
Yeah. Well, Tony, if you ask me for the 2 ringgit, I will gladly give you at the time.
You know, you might not have at that time. Not many people believe. One of the great things, and there's a third lesson here. I just want to go back a little bit. I've always wanted to be an entrepreneur.
Yep.
Always, always, always. From a young age, I wanted to do a fast food restaurant. I wanted to own an airline, et cetera, et cetera. And I've had two of those dreams already now with Santan and the airline. But I never thought I had the courage to be an entrepreneur. The second gift is, for all these people listening, is you got to spot someone who has that ability to deliver what they say. That is, you know, that is gold. And ability to spot talent and take that talent and make it into something, turn that raw diamond into diamond. That's the gift of business, really. And so, you know, now you give me the 2 ringgit, but maybe 19 years ago or 20 years ago, you would have said, nutcase, you know, this doesn't fit in with my Oxford Cambridge education. I'm not going to give you the 2 ringgit. But that's the gift. That's the gift.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Tan Sri, so going back to my question earlier, so you've been here for around about 20 years now, almost 20 years. I'm sure along that time, there's been a lot of transformational shifts that you have done within AirAsia, right? So what is your principle in transforming a company, especially internally, right?
Principle is never stand still. Always on the lookout for change. Companies don't like to change. Malaysians don't like to change, right? Though we seem to be changing government often. We don't like change. And so companies stay too long doing something. And they're great examples of that. Nokia, BlackBerry, you know, I mean, you're too young, but we all grew up with Nokia phones. Then we all grew up with BlackBerry phones, right? They're gone. For those older in the audience, which probably, you know, we all grew up with Kodak cameras. That doesn't exist anymore, right? So I always say change management. I'm never standing still. That's a bit frustrating for my management sometimes because, you know, they don't have a day to rest before I'm saying change this, change that, change the brand, merge this, et cetera, et cetera. But change management is critical. And so you have to transform every day. You know, these companies that go in and hire management consultants to transform, you know, I think it's more of this digital world. So when people talk about agile management, that's what AirAsia was. We were an agile company that changed every day. And so transformation is not something you sit down and say, I'm going to transform.
Yep.
Number one, you have to have the culture and the people that have the ability to want to transform. That's number one. And then, you know, transformation is not to me about just sitting down and saying transform. It's about an everyday thing. Every day you've got to look at getting better. You know, and I said it's a journey. I said safety is a journey. Culture is a journey. Transformation is every day. You've got to transform every day to survive.
Yep. But that brings up a very interesting point because the companies that you said, like Nokia, Kodak, what they've suffered is a lot of it is can be attributed to complacency, right? How do you avoid that within your own company? Because like you said, a lot of your management is like, I can't move this fast. But
I how do you avoid that complacency? Ego. I you can ask my management. I always say you're only as good as tomorrow.
Right.
No one remembers you. You know, if you take a QPR fan, wow, I was God when I brought them back up to the Premier League at Wembley Stadium. 2 years later, they wanted to execute me, right? So memories are very short and success is not something you should hang on to for much longer. Too many companies build themselves on egos, think they're irreplaceable, and before you know it, they're gone. So humility, is the most important criteria of a good manager. Being humble, being able to learn every day, being able to learn from different people. I learned the best things from my junior staff, right? So, I would say that those are crucial elements in terms of being where we are and then transforming, is the ability to absorb, to learn, to change, and to listen, and to be humble. Because, you know, the more cocky you become, the quicker you will be destroyed. And it's a common message I say. I always tell my staff, don't be arrogant. Don't think you're better than you are. And I say to football players, the moment you believe you're the best, that's the beginning of the end. The moment you believe that you don't work, and the irony between corporations and football clubs are so similar. When you see a star football player, really star, you know, we had a player called Adel Taarabt from Morocco, one of the most talented players I've ever seen, better than Ronaldo, really, but didn't apply himself, just didn't use his God-given talent to become that superstar. Ronaldo works. He works.
Yeah.
I mean, he's out there. I've seen him at Old Trafford after training sessions, still practicing. So there is no secret. Malaysians always look for that shortcut. Always look for that shortcut. There is no shortcut in life. It is all about hard work and taking your chances. There is luck, for sure, but you've got to make that luck and you've got to take your chances.
So I guess a lot of it is really to cover your blind spots, and that comes with building a good team around you, and that also means working as hard as you possibly can, right, Tan Sri?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. 100%. Prisman, you really struggle between Tony and Tan Sri.
Yeah.
Just call me Tony.
I'll keep it with Tony.
So, no one in AirAsia calls me Tan Sri. It's really weird. Everyone calls Din, Dato Din. But no one calls me Tan Sri. Boss. Okay. Tony, bro, very rarely does.
I'll try to keep it to Tony for now.
Yeah. That's a transformation for you.
But so Tony, the current situation for the airline industry has arguably never been more challenging, right? So you have moments here, you have border closures there, and it seems like no one can travel anywhere now. And maybe you have some in Europe, but so AirAsia on its part has shifted to this digital industry with the intent to create a low-cost unicorn super app. Am I correct to say that?
Yeah. I'm really happy you said that because I started saying that about a month ago.
Yeah. But what does that mean? Because it's like three things at once, right? It's like a low-cost, it's a unicorn, it's also a super app. So what does that mean for AirAsia and for you?
Well, let's take it one step back. You know, people forget that we were a tech company before most of these companies were out of their pram. Okay, so, you know, before Foodpanda was Foodpanda and he was Baby Panda or, you know, Sperm Panda, we were already selling airline tickets on the internet, right? We were the first digital company truly in Malaysia to embrace the internet and use the internet as its mode of distribution. So we understood digital. It's our roots. We were the first airline to really embrace social media, good and bad, right? And we were hammered for refunds, et cetera, but we're there, social media. So, and we understood the power of data. And so we, you know, I always had arguments with my staff not to work with travel agents, not to give up the magazine to a third party, always keep it. Not because I saw this data revolution, but because I thought I always wanted a link with the customer.
Right.
And I think when you break your link with your customer, that's the beginning of the end. When a middleman does your job, that's the beginning of the end. And in my entire life, I've always tried to maintain the relationship with the customer direct. And that's in physical and digital. So when I travel the plane with AirAsia, I'm the only CEO who goes out there and meets every single passenger. Every single flight, right? Can't do it now for obvious reasons, but you know, I'll do it. I'll meet people in the airport, I'll walk around the airport. And it's not always pleasant. There are a lot of people who want to, you know, are upset with us. But I think to maintain your relationship with customers. So the transformation was a natural one because we already were doing it. And then I looked and said, well, what do we have? I've always been utilizing our assets more. We took our academy, we made it a business. We're taking our engineering business and making it a business. We've taken our ground handling business and created a business. We took our in-flight food and made it a business. So what's our biggest asset was actually our data and AirAsia.com,
yeah,
which had 60 million people coming every month. So we created AirAsia Digital. And you know, after lots of ums and ahs, we've created three businesses: the super app, teleport, our logistics arm, and Big Pay, which is our aim of trying to build an inclusive bank for ASEAN. Mm-hmm. And you know, going through the three things you said, low cost. Yep, we want to be high efficiency, so we get the two ways of being low cost, right? Well, giving good value, right? So low cost means the idea of a low cost is that by having low cost, you can sell things cheaper, right? In the digital world, they're low cost, but it's funded by shareholders,
yes,
right? So they don't make money. Yep. They just give away their product, right? So, you know, if someone gives me 10 billion, I can go do that easily, right? And go build a super app by giving away food and giving away taxi rides, et cetera, et cetera. Much harder to go build an airline when people's not giving you money. So we want to be low cost and highly efficient so we can build a sustainable digital business that makes profits. So the super app was one. And a unicorn, yeah, you know, that's a word I didn't create. But obviously, that's the next step for us to build a unicorn. And to be inclusive, if I could just add that thing in. AirAsia was about inclusivity, right? Allowing everyone to fly. We want everyone to allow to get a load. We want everyone to be able to use logistics cheaply. We want everyone to be able to, and inclusivity in terms of our food delivery service, everyone can get to it, but it's for the restaurants to be included. It's also inclusivity is about not just serving Kuala Lumpur, but to give a great service to Sungai Petani, right? Yeah. What did AirAsia do? We didn't just fly to the capital cities. MAS and SIA just flew to the capital cities. We flew and created routes from KL to Tawau, from KL to Sandakan, direct, which was never done before in the history of Malaysian aviation. So inclusivity is a very large part of what we're trying to do.
So Tan Sri, you mentioned earlier that it's all about, you know, giving value to your customers, right? So in this space, you see that in the airline industry, it's all about giving people the value of flying cheaply. But what is the principle for people who say, for their own in general, how do you find value for customers?
In the digital world? Well, let's do it step by step. So in the banking world, very easy, right? You either get a loan at the moment from a bank in Malaysia, which is virtually impossible. And if you do manage to get a loan, you have to provide security. And that defeats half the object. Most of the people on the line who want to get a loan for a business don't have security. That's why they're going to get a loan. So in Malaysia, you might have to give your first child away as security as well to get a loan. So, and it will take you, you know, years to get the loan. Literally, AirAsia is going through that right now. So what do? We try and make loans. And then, so the alternative is this illegal market of loan sharks,
yep,
right? And so what do? We, you know, same way in AirAsia, you could either fly on MAS and, you know, 20 years ago and pay a lot more money, or you take a boat or a train or a dodgy ferry, right? So AirAsia came in and provided an alternative. So Big Pay will provide alternatives for financing, for loans, for people who have money and want to build some wealth management products. You don't have to be in a private bank to be able to own unit trusts or trade in currencies. And I think that's something a lot of your listeners are doing a great job, and I hope Binance and people like those aren't made illegal. And then logistics to allow all these social sellers, many of it will be listening today, can only sell their goods in KL probably, or in the city they come from. How do we get some of these great social media sellers to be able to sell their goods overseas? So we have the most amazing chocolate company is in KL, and now Teleport is providing them logistics throughout ASEAN. Their business in Singapore is growing. So making logistics inclusive and affordable for the common man. And then the super app is mostly about delivery and travel to make it affordable, to make it cheaper. And then later on, we want to do education, we want to do health and wealth management. So those principles are there. I think you're trying to say, how can we be better than Grab or Food Panda? Is probably what you really wanted to ask me. You know, we can, you know, Fisman will say, I can understand how you competed with MAS, but I don't understand how you're going to compete with Grab. So I'll answer you now. One, it isn't a zero-sum game. Right. It isn't just about Grab, right? There's always going to be a competitor. There never has been one, right? Whether we succeed is something else. Yeah. But we're not trying to be Grab or Food Panda. Food delivery is just one small part of our super app. We're trying to be the best. We're trying to be more. We're trying to be more Traveloka first, and then more DHL in cross-border delivery with some great e-commerce delivery options. So that we've looked very carefully at where we can be. Even ride-hailing. Very soon, you'll be able to use AirAsia rides. How do we compete with someone like Grab? Well, I think in the airport, we're really strong. I would know Fisman's coming back from somewhere way before Grab knows. And the airport market is a strong market. I would know Fisman and his three girlfriends are going to Langkawi, and they all kind of live next to each other. And so I'll offer them, do you want to go together? Because you're all flying on the same flight, right? So the airport market, the tourism market is there for us. Our rewards program is very strong. So there'll be a natural tendency for some people to use AirAsia rides. And our service will be a bit different. So at each, we've thought about this very carefully. Yep. It isn't charging in like a bull in a china shop. We believe we will have some strong followers, some people who love our brand and will use us. And we'll have some inherent advantages in everything we do. Our beauty product, for instance, we have a huge amount of discounts from our in-flight sales. We know all the brands. Yeah. And so we'll create our own kind of Sephora online. We think the grocery business under Joanna and Benji will do amazing. So every little thing we've thought about. So there is value, there is market opportunities, and there is segmentation. Our restaurants, you know, we're signing up restaurants quicker than Jack Robinson because we're only charging 15%, right, while the others are charging 30%. How do we do that? We're low cost, so we can make money at 15%, right? It's as simple as that. Low cost will always win. Sustainable businesses will always win. You can raise capital, give away products, but there's a point in time, cash flow has to count. And if there's one man who understands that, it's Idris, right? So you can keep raising capital and have, you know, these benefactors like SoftBank and whoever giving you loads of capital. But at some point, people want you to make money.
Exactly.
You know.
So you don't believe in this growth at all costs mindset that some of these have?
No.
Yeah.
So. Look, I'm a big believer in growth. We took an airline from 2 planes to 245 planes. Yep. We've made AirAsia the fourth largest airline in Asia. Only 3 Chinese airlines are bigger than us, and they have a slight advantage of 1.3 billion people in their country, right? Small advantage.
Yeah.
So we've done pretty well to be number 4 in the world. So I want to grow, but I want to grow sustainably.
Correct.
You know, it's amazing. I came in, I'm sure, you know, some people may not agree with me, but I came in and had to fight an airline that had loads. MAS has received close to 30 or 40 billion ringgit since AirAsia has been in existence,
yep.
Right? Someone in Khazana said to me they could have bought SIA for that, okay, for the amount of money the Khazana and the government has put in. It's okay. I'm now faced with digital companies who have similar kind of Khazanas pumping in money the whole time.
Yes.
But at some point, the money runs out, right? So I do believe in growth, but I believe in sustainable growth.
I see.
I don't believe in shoppy growth or grab growth.
So you believe in the AirAsia growth?
Yeah, I believe in organic, sustainable cash flow growth. Maybe I have no choice because no one gives us money. Yeah. So we have no choice, right?
No.
That's how it goes.
Yeah. So how has that journey been for you and AirAsia so far? Because there is that shift from focusing purely on airlines, and now you have two focus. You have this digital business, you also have...
Yeah, so we've created two, what I'm trying to get, and I mean, even tempted to change AirAsia Group's name, because we're not just an airline anymore. Now, I'm never going to get the analysts, you know, to give us any credit for our digital. They did just sit there and say, AirAsia is going to go bust. And so the stock is worthless, right? Well, another digital company loses 8 billion and they're worth 40 billion. So go figure, right? We might change AirAsia Group into like a holding company, like IAC or something, right? And IAC will hold two assets, right? AirAsia Aviation, which we've just created. We have an engineering company called ADE. GTR, which is a ground handling and warehouse company, and Santam. And then on the digital side is AirAsia Digital, run by Irene. The aviation group's run by Bo Lingam. And we have those three companies underneath. So they're kind of independent now. They share data amongst each other. They share assets amongst each other, but they kind of run independently. And one day they may be split up.
Running on their own independently outside of Asia.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, if you think about it, eBay and PayPal,
right?
You know, PayPal was a subsidiary of eBay. And then they split it up and PayPal went on to huge things and eBay kind of more or less stood where it was. So there will be a point that we will split these things up.
I see. But so you, when we were speaking earlier, you mentioned a lot about how people are very important in your company. Right.
Mm.
In that shift from your airline business to the digital side, especially now with airlines effectively at zero activity, has there been a lot of reassignments from the airline side to the digital?
Yeah, 100%.
And
100%. I mean, if you look at our CEOs, you know, the CEO of the Super App is from the airline business.
Right.
The CEO of the Teleport is from the airline business. That goes back to that transformation. I don't need to import all this talent. If I have people who can change, who can adapt, who understand principles of business, whether you're running a tech company or whether you're running a football club, or whether you're running an airline, it's the same principles. Maximize the top line, minimize the cost, create a profit, and have a balance sheet that has a lot of cash in it, right? So we have transformed. In Teleport, our top data scientists are two pilots. Irene Omar did an amazing job. 2 years before COVID, we built an academy called Red Beat Academy and partnered Google to transform our staff. You talk about transformation. And so we're always transforming, right? We're always thinking about how. So we did this because we thought all of our staff were going to be out of a job because of digital. And I thought that'd be really unfair because we have some great people who've been very loyal to us. So we built this academy. Now it took on a much bigger role because of COVID. When we had a lot of pilots and cabin crew out of a job. But that's been a very important element in moving. And it shows that talent can be transformed as well, right? So all the analysts will say, oh, you know, AirAsia is an airline. How are they going to compete with these tech companies? You know, so it's the ability to transform, which has been our biggest strength.
But I guess the thing that helps that transformation is also that within AirAsia, the airline industry, airline business, AirAsia, the digital business, the fundamentals are the same, right? Like you mentioned earlier,
it's
bringing value to people. So even if you have people from the airline side going to the digital side, they know what needs to be done in the first place. They understand. Would that be a
absolute?
Yeah.
Absolutely. You got it in one. You're the first man, Fizman. You get a gold star and a free flight to Wuhan, the safest place in the world. Actually, maybe not the safest place anymore. Yeah, COVID's back there.
Yeah.
But you're right. The principles, and no one has picked that up. Yep. You're the first guy to pick that up. The principles of running our tech company are exactly the same as the airline.
Yeah.
Manage cash, get low costs, high efficiency. So I'm not trying to get 40,000 restaurants on our food platform. Right. We're trying to get, because it's an 80-20 rule, right? Most of your restaurants are, your top 20% are contributing 80% of your business. So we try and do that. Just like we didn't try to have first class, business class, premium economy, turboprop, little planes, big planes, 380s. You know, we just had the 320. So there's a lot to be learned from AirAsia in applying to our digital business.
But has that been difficult for them, the people working, shifting from the airline industry to...
Yeah, I mean, you have to ask some of those people. But I mean, it is a ship. It is a massive ship, and to steer it is quite a transformation, right?
Right.
But I don't think I could have done it in any other company. I think the ability of all stars to adapt, mm-hmm. to get on with the job, to not moan so much. Mm-hmm. And then ultimately not everyone likes that, right? So some people will leave. Some people will leave for better jobs. Some people will leave for the fact that they didn't join for this journey. And so that's fine. But, you know, majority have stayed for the ride, and that's incredible with all that we've gone through. That's incredible.
And so, Tony, this whole digital business, I'm sure it's part of a larger AirAsia thing where you always have ideas to further grow and diversify your business, correct? How do you decide when something is no longer worth pursuing, or how do you even decide this is worth pursuing?
Oh, yeah, that's a really good question as well. That's where ego comes in, right?
Right.
Because if it's your idea, you know, it's hard to give up. Mm-hmm. You know, AirAsia Japan, I know it's going to work, but we had to give it up because it was just a bottomless pit. And then COVID came along, but we probably ran it longer than we should have.
Mm-hmm.
So too many corporations take too long to pull out of bad decisions. And we're the same, you know, because it's, you put your blood and soul into it.
Right.
You don't want to throw it away, right? And I see that with all my staff. I've become more ruthless at that. And, you know, we were going into one part of the business, and Joanna was running it. And I said, look, it really doesn't make sense. You know, she was like, no, give me a bit more time. Give me a bit more time. And then to her credit, she came back and said, yeah, you know, I think we should be in this. So that is something I've become better at.
Yeah.
It's not something that I came naturally. I'm giving up the route. You know, you put a lot of effort. You love the people in this town. And then you just don't make money, and it can't work. It's emotional, right? We've got better at it, and definitely COVID has made us better for sure, right? Because even as I go on about efficiency and we're tight and we're low cost, every organization has fat, and I'm not talking about my stomach, which has been a big issue in my life, an ever going battle, every organization has fat in their organization. And, you know, COVID is one of the beauties of COVID is that it's enabled us to make those hard decisions and reset. It's a once in a lifetime chance to start again. It's almost like starting the airline again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, literally. You know, I talk about it in a funny way in Snakes and Ladders, right? I don't know if you ever played that game. It's a simple game, so you may not have. But you know, you go up to square 97 and there's a snake that brings you all the way down to 3.
Right.
That's kind of where we are, you know. we're back to flying 3 planes a day. So, but you can put your heads in the sand and cry about it, which a lot of people do, or you can just get on with it and you know, use this opportunity to reskill yourself and restructure everything.
Yeah. So would you say this, the pandemic that we have right now, accelerated the whole shift towards digital?
Oh, 100%, 100%. Yeah.
So without
100%, because you have, you know, when you're running an airline with 90 million people, even as amazing a management team you may be, you don't have the time to sit down and really think. When you're locked down for sitting at home, you get a lot of spare time to really analyze and to really look at what the competitors are doing and to get ideas and stuff. So that's a benefit of COVID.
Yeah. So this, apart from the current pandemic that we're facing, what would you say is the biggest challenge that you've faced so far?
The pandemic, you know, I used to say in my speeches, I've been tested. You know, there's nothing that scares me.
Right.
The first lesson is just shut your mouth, because, you know, I thought COVID would last 3 months, right? It could last for 3 years. You know, another lesson, never think you've seen everything or you've done everything, because suddenly the world will say, here's something. And boy, you know, COVID is worse than one of those Hollywood movies, right? I mean, you know, it's real. And that's COVID by far is the toughest challenge. But an emotional challenge, really, losing an aircraft in Indonesia was the toughest time of my life and continues to be the toughest time of my life. You know, QZ8501. You know, many of you working in different businesses, you don't carry people's lives in your hands. And I did, but you never realize it till something happens. And then you're the CEO of an airline that caused people to lose their lives. And so that was the toughest thing for me, because, you know, I never expected it. And there are two ways of dealing with it. And I dealt with it in the only way I know how to, front on. The lawyers said, you don't have to go. It's an Indonesian airline. And I said, are you guys crazy? This is our brand. And I have to be there for the staff. It's just not just about the good things. You've got to be there. So, you know, we took it on and it was, wow, really hard to go and meet 100 families. I met every single family personally. I gave my mobile phone number to every single one. And, you know, what are you saying? What do you do? But you have to do that as a leader. But it was tough. And still, till this day, even with COVID, I would say it's my toughest time.
So I guess that goes back to having empathy, right, in dealing with customers, not only dealing with people within your organization, but also with your customers as well, understanding where they're coming from and the emotions that comes with it. And that's a very important part, like you mentioned earlier, in running AirAsia. So Tan Sri, going back to this challenging situation that we're having right now, what would your advice be for entrepreneurs to navigate this whole situation?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think number one, if you're still in business, you won. You know, congratulations. And you should be damn bloody proud of yourself.
Right.
In any business, you know, building a house, selling a house online, like my friend at High Home, being in an airline. I tell my staff, we've won. We're alive. This is like surviving World War II, right? And now we have to rebuild, like Japan rebuilt and Germany rebuilt and Western Europe rebuilt. So congratulations for being alive, step one. 18 months into this pandemic, be proud of yourselves. That's a victory. Second is, this is the beginning of the end, right? It's going to end.
Yes.
There are a lot of negative people out there. Yeah, but I mean, you know, there's an element of this money. All right, it's going to end. We survived AIDS. We survived Spanish flu, right? We've survived many crises, and we will survive this.
Yeah.
And so, one, be happy that you've survived. Two, remember cash flow is key.
Yeah.
Three, surround yourselves with great people. Four, adapt and pivot your product, right? This is the time. to adapt and pivot really quick. This is a CD moment for those of you who are too young. When I was in the music business, to go from cassettes to CD was a big thing, right? Three times the price. COVID has accelerated the digital world. It ain't gonna change, right? The digital world is here. So adapt your business and market. Don't forget good old fashioned marketing. And finally, human relationships. Too many tech companies think it's all about the product.
Yep.
It's still a people's business. And so you know, don't remember that. But it's a wonderful time if you survive, because there's gonna be revenge growth. There's going to be a chance that, you know, for me in AirAsia, it's a great leveler that we can catch up in countries where we were weaker.
Yep.
And so I'm excited. And look, I think by the end of this year, most of the world will go back to seeing COVID as another disease, as AIDS or as the flu. More people die from the flu, right?
Yeah.
So, but we don't lock ourselves in anymore. So, vaccines are going very well. They work. And if there are any anti-vaxxers out here, I'm the most pro-vaxxer in the world. If I could take all the vaccines, I would. You know, I'd be jabbed every day if I could. It's working. It's stopping people from dying.
Yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately, I haven't changed. I'm still overweight. I still have hair. So the vaccine hasn't transformed me into something else. So it is going to end. It is a great time to be in business. It's a great time to pivot. It's a great time to look at transforming your company. And I would say it's a great time to look at regional expansion.
So, yeah, so that's a good point. Adapt and pivot is something, I think that's what a lot of people have been saying. And I think early on in the pandemic, everyone was talking about how this would be the great reset, not only for the structure of the world, but also in businesses at a smaller level, right? So yes, adapt and pivot, I agree. But on a lighter note, Tan Sri, tell us a bit about your podcast. So you recently launched a podcast called Talks with Tony. You've had So the latest episode was with Les Ferdinand, if I'm mistaken, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So tell us a bit about that.
Well, it wasn't my idea. It was someone in the office called Mariana, who runs communications. This is one of the beauties of AirAsia, right? That we have a very flat structure, so anyone can come up with an idea. In fact, my TikTok account, I didn't even agree to a TikTok account. You know, one of my young Filipino staff created a TikTok account, and now I have 260,000 followers, right? She didn't even ask me permission. this is a 24-year-old. So this is the beauty of AirAsia. And so Mariana said, look, you have so many great friends and you've been on the other side, always being interviewed like I am now. Why don't you try being interviewer? And I went, yeah, that sounds great. And so, you know, we started the first series. The first one was about my staff interviewing me.
Oh, I see.
And then the second one is really important one for all Malaysians. I would really go out and listen to this one. And I learned so much from it. I brought, you know, three of my good friends who are from different backgrounds. And that kind of episode and the others with Les Ferdinand and Dana White is coming on Sunday, is about people learning from them, right? You know, and I learned as much from them as hopefully some of you have learned some things from me today. So the Malaysian one was fantastic. You know, our forefathers really had it right with the Rukun Negara. Mm-hmm. And if you read the Independence Day speech by Tunku Abdul Rahman, our forefathers thought about it all, you know, and the script is there. How we screwed it up, I don't understand. But the lesson is there. If you go back to the American Constitution, how did they get it so right? 200 years, 300 years, that Constitution still serves the Americans. We have an amazing Constitution in Malaysia.
Yeah.
We have an amazing piece of document called the Rukun Negara. And we had amazing forefathers who had a great vision for Malaysia. So that podcast is for a generation such as you, Fizman, to kind of learn a little bit from some of us older guys. And then Les Ferdinand is, you know, it's a chance for Malaysians and Thais and Indonesians to hear one of the greatest footballers in the world talk about how he became such a great footballer and some great anecdotes. And then Dana White, how he built UFC and so on and so forth. So it's, I got better at it because it's hard being an interviewer. It's easy being interviewed and, you know, you have to sit there and listen to me, right? And you may want to say, shut up, Tony, I've got another question for you. But it's harder. So it's the same for me. When someone's talking, I'm like, I'm so used to talking. It's hard to keep my mouth shut. So it's a great training. Yeah. But I hope people find it of some use.
Right. Well, on that note, Tanshree, Tony, you have a TikTok account. I don't have one. So I'm guessing you're much younger than me in that sense.
Yeah, you know, I am 57, actually. I'm probably one of the oldest dudes on TikTok. But, you know, it kind of keeps me young at heart. I love to know what's going on in the world. And
right.
If you're not on TikTok, you don't know what the hell's going on in the world. So I've learned so much. And I credit my staff for doing that.
Sure. Thanks so much, Tony. So, we have arrived at the Q&A segment of this round back. Tony, it is all right.
Do you know, Fizman, I hope my staff didn't edit the questions.
No, they didn't.
I did have a quick look, but you know, you said there was an elephant in the room. You should have asked me that question.
If you want me to ask the question, I'm more than okay.
You should ask me that question because I talk about transparency and I'm not going to run away from anything because I'm sure one of my SS stormtroopers in communication said, you can't ask this question. I didn't read all your questions.
Right.
Because I think it should be fresh, but I remember looking at it and I remember seeing a question which said elephant in the room.
Sure.
There should never be elephants in the room.
Okay. Then
you should always feel comfortable to ask the questions. We should never censor. And we should always be prepared to ask anything. So ask me the elephant in the room question.
So let's address the elephant in the room then.
Isn't an elephant. It's been addressed. We should ask it.
Yeah. So there is this video that came out of the Thai executive chairman responding to someone in a rather distasteful manner, I would say. What do you think about that? What's your response to that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, firstly, there have been two shocks in my life. Right. One is, three actually. One is looking at myself in the mirror after having been a fantastic sportsman and realizing I looked like Jabba the Hutt from a Star Wars movie. Second was QZ8501. And the third was this incident. It's just never happened, right?
Right.
I know some of the press and people want to make stories of it and say our culture is toxic and all kinds of stuff. That's a story, actually. It's another story which I'm going to talk to you about. But, I was in shock. I was in shock, right? Because it was very uncharacteristic. He's incredibly well-loved in Thailand. He's built the airline from nothing. I've known him for 30 years, and it was just uncharacteristic, right? And so we were all caught there, me, Irene, etc. And I asked people, what would you have done? And everyone kind of looks at me like I said, I don't know. I don't know how to react. We had 500 people listening. Did I want to make another scene, et cetera, et cetera. So behind the scenes, I said, please remove him from this presentation. Mm-hmm. Right. And straight afterwards, I called the two girls involved and, explained and apologized. And we launched an investigation. Is it acceptable? Absolutely not.
Yeah.
No, it's not. Does it mean he's the worst leader in the world because of one incident? No.
Yeah.
Right? Does every organization have elements of that once in a while? Yes, but it needs to be corrected. Have standards, are young people more demanding of certain standards than 20-year-old veterans in the airline? Yes, and that's why culture is an ever-growing move. Are we perfect? No. Can we be better? Yes. Do we swear a lot in meetings? Probably. Probably, but is it in malice? No. Right. And so what I found was people turning it into a sexist comment. There is no company in Malaysia that has done more for women than AirAsia. None. Right? Can we do more? Absolutely. But diversity is not just about women, just as a sidetrack. Okay? I'll come back to that in a second. But we were the first airline to have female pilots. You look at our senior management, from Irene, chief legal officer, CFO, whatever. There are women everywhere in our organization. How people could turn that around into a women's issue, some of our competitors, was shocking to me, right? Taskforce could have said that, and he was abusive to me, by the way, in that meeting, right? No one heard that bit. So that, I think, is a tragedy of the world, that discrimination is on every. In fact, if you listen to Les Ferdinand's podcast, he's very against taking the bending of the knee, because he says that's tokenism. Right. He wants to see a Black person leading the FA. He wants to see more Black managers. He's the first director of football who's a Black guy,
yeah,
right, at QPR. So, you know, discrimination is not just about women. It's a very important part. At AirAsia, we have focused on age diversity. We were the first airline to allow cabin crew to retire whenever they want. Not at some airlines, women have to retire at 45. We also promote youth diversity. We have very young people at senior positions, because in Asia, you can't be senior leader if you're not old, right? That's just, it's a feudal way of looking at things. We're now bringing neurodiversity into our airline, that we think it's important to give kids with neuro issues a chance. It's just another disease. We subscribe to people talking about their mental issues, of which we've had a lot in this COVID period, that it's just another disease. So, you know, incidents happen.
Yeah.
Was distasteful. People can look at it glass half full, glass half empty, and say, oh, Tony and Irene did nothing. Oh, you don't know the whole story, right? And you can't run down 20 years of a culture with not a single industrial action on one video. And it was interesting that our competitors leapt on it to try and bring it down. It was interesting that, you know, some women in AirAsia leapt on it. And I said, well, did you call me up? Did you ask me? Did you speak to the girl and offer a comfort? And they all looked and said, yeah, maybe we could have done better as well, right? And then all these people on LinkedIn, all these coaches, and they're all tagging me because they all wanted me to respond, because then they become more famous, you know? So, you know, and then you see digital magazines trying to sell more premium subscriptions by creating sensational stories.
Right.
Fame is not always a good thing, because people want to make money out of your fame, or want to bring you down. But I stand by our culture. I'm incredibly proud of our culture. I'm incredibly proud of taking a dispatch boy and making him a captain. I'm incredibly proud of taking a cabin crew, a female cabin crew, and making her a pilot. I'm incredibly proud of Irene Omar being the number two in the company.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we stand by our culture. It's not an elephant in the room. But no company is 100% perfect. But as long as we stand up and say we can be better, yeah, we're going to be better. And we learn. And maybe some of the things I say needs to be changed, and we'll change it.
Sure. So then I guess the principle goes back to the transformation principle. You always have to be transforming. And that comes from taking the good and improving it. But at parts where you sort of have deficiencies, then that's where you say, I can be better in this particular space, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's everything, right? We pride ourselves in our culture. We pride ourselves in diversification and diversity. But then someone says, hey, well, maybe you can be better.
Yeah.
Now, there are two ways of taking it. There's the defensive way, which is, oh, no, we're great already, which would be my initial reaction sometimes. And then you sit back 1 hour later and say, yeah, we can be better. And so that's... that's the mark of a good company. We can stand back and say we made mistakes and get better.
Sure.
So the question goes, it goes without saying that both of you have a mountain of experience in the airline industry, but the pandemic has hit this industry particularly hard. We know that vaccines have started rolling out, and you've spoken a little bit, Tony, about what things might be looking like by the end of the year. But it would be interesting to hear from both of you, where do you see the future of air travel specifically and the industry is headed towards given the realities that we see right now? Maybe we can hear from Idris first.
Well, the first thing is that we all know that the pandemic will end. There's no such thing the pandemic will permanently be there. It will go away. We already know the answer lies in the vaccination program. The quicker we get people to be vaccinated, the more people are immune to the illness, then people can go and become normal. I'm very happy that the English Premier League has started, you know, and now people are living quite normally out there. So I do believe air travels will continue. There's a pent-up demand for it. As soon as things are opening up, people will travel. I haven't been to Kuching to see my mother for more than a year now. You know, she, I call her on the phone and she asked me, when am I going to go there? You know, so I think there are a lot of people just waiting for the day to travel and to visit the rest of the world and see. So I think without doubt, there's need for it. But I think what is happening here today is that businesses in the hospitality industry, like travel industry, they are taking the time now to diversify. What Tony and the team are doing to pivot, adapt and pivot, it's absolutely critical. I mean, they will become better, much better than they were before, because they would have now really understood better the customers and the offering in their diversification. So I think a lot of people who learn how to survive and then the right way and come with new business model that will make them a lot more sustainable will succeed. So I think that is the other thing that will happen in the travel industry, in the airline industry. There will be some consolidation. Some airlines would permanently die and they cannot survive. Tony is right. If you survive, fantastic. The ones that will die, some they will not serve those routes. The airlines are still standing. Then they will really take a lot of strength from those. So hopefully, you know, Tony, the ones who survive, stands steady still. They will grab the opportunity when people start traveling again.
Tony, so what about you? How do you see the airline industry looking like in moving forward into the long term?
Yeah, I don't think there's going to be a lot of change, to be honest. I think, you know, after 9/11, security became crazy. Going into America was like a nightmare. We all got used to it. It got better. It's going to take a bit of a while. You know, health protocol is going to be there. You're going to be things stuck up your nose for a while. And that might change to breathing into apparatus or whatever. But travel won't change. I think in the short term, airlines such as AirAsia benefit tremendously because you're more likely to fly to Phuket than to Acapulco. And I think business travel will definitely be affected for the long term, definitely. Will it recover to post-pandemic times? I don't think so. I think at the front end of the plane, you're going to get very luxurious. You're going to get more private jets. You're going to get more people wanting to be on smaller planes than those who can afford it. I think first class may disappear, but I think a kind of premium short-haul airline is going to happen big time. I think package tours are finished. I think people don't want to get on a bus with 150 other people they don't know. So I think that's gone. But, you know, I think for a while, travel is going to be a little bit inconvenient, but we'll get used to it and we'll move on. I think, as Idris says, travel will come back very, very strongly. It's something, you know, what are people doing? They're not traveling and they're going out and buying Chanel bags and stuff, right? And I was in Seoul and there's a massive queue to buy Chanel bags and you can see it. But when travel comes back, people will travel massively. I don't think it'll be a massive change. Certain things like I've just mentioned.
All right. So what we can expect certainly.
Well, one thing I hope to see changes, and I mean, this is, I hope governments will allow airlines to die if they need to die.
Yeah.
Right. I think, I'm not just referring to these Malaysian airlines or whatever, I'm not saying Malaysian airlines should die, but if the business model isn't sustainable, taxpayers should not continue to support it. Too much money has gone into airlines around the world. And I've never, it's a thesis I want to do, why governments do that. It's not like they're the biggest employer or whatever. But I think it's a great time for businesses and governments to say, right, do we need a national airline? Is that money better spent on PLUS or education or improving our health system? I mean, I'm just being honest and serious here as a Malaysian, right? And that also can be said for other countries. So one thing I hope is changes that the airline industry is not held together by plaster and subsidies, that the airline industry comes out as a good returner of capital and run on a profitable manner.
Well, thank you for that, Tony, for your thoughts on that. Unfortunately, we've run out of time, but thank you so much, Tony, for sharing your thoughts with us. Thank you so much to all of the audience members who've submitted questions. So many great questions. Unfortunately, not enough time. We feel it's really unfortunate we didn't have time to hear all of them, but we're confident that everyone will leave this session benefiting from Tony's valuable insights regardless. Now, I would like to invite Idris up here for his closing remarks and to conclude this month's edition of the Brown Bag series. The floor is yours, Idris.
Yeah, thank you very much, Tony. And the reason why we organized this was because I felt that during the pandemic, that people are disconnected. We really wanted people to come together so that we can learn from one another and learn from other people. So this is our way of surviving, if you like, in PEMANDU. And we thought we'd connect some of our clients and friends that they come and join us as well. And we also make sure that the guys who organize the event, like Fizman, you know, and like Ms. Zal, these are some younger guys. They've never done this before. In fact, the first session we had with Nazir, we got a lady who was the youngest that just joined us within a month. And we got her to do the Q&A. So we're really for learning by doing, like get them to do it.
Well, they did great. They did great.
This is the first time that I've seen Fizman do it. He's done a very good job, and Ms. Zal as well, except for the technical issue. So I got some key takeaways, you know, many, many lessons learned. I would put them in three buckets, like a triangle. The first bucket is on entrepreneurship. The second bucket is on transformation. The third one is on people management. On entrepreneurship, we have learned from Tony a few things, that cash is a very, very important way of managing company the way he sees it. And also, you have to create a business model that people want to buy your product. If you create a business model that people don't buy it, then you cannot succeed in entrepreneurship. So he believes the low-cost model, he really believes that is the way to survive. Low-cost will always win, the comment he made there. So he believes in sustainable growth that comes from a solid foundation. He illustrates earlier on that if you want to build a solid business, you have to have a structure right. The platforms must be robust. And he's saying today on transformation, so adapt and pivot. It's a very big lesson that to be learned. That actually, transformation is part of crisis management. He talked a lot about all the crises that he's gone through. And that every day he says, you must transform. That means transformation is an everyday activity. It's not something that somebody sits there in the room and come with a strategy for the company. It's something that you do every single day. And never stand still was a term that he used. And that's why he quoted Nokia and BlackBerry. They've come and gone because they stood still and they will become so complacent. And so on people management, I mean, on transformation, the pivot point was about him diversifying into the digital business. And this is the opportunity for them, again, to pivot, take the crisis, learn from it, move on to look at other things to expand your businesses. And that's why they and in Asia, they chose digital business to do that, to pivot. On people's side, the third bucket is there's a lot of lessons learned there. You talk about spotting talent. And that's absolutely important. I completely agree with him that you've got to spot the right talent. And not only spot them, but really harness them. Get the best out from them. And so the second thing that he talked about was the lessons about walking the talk, be out there on the field and meet people and talk to them and engage the staff. And people in the organization need to be very hungry to hire people that are very hungry and agile, because an organization that's stuck and not agile, they're not in sync with that transformation that the business is going through. And so he says that social media is a very powerful tool for internal communication. I think many behemoth companies, they use very traditional tools to communicate. And so I do agree with Tony that social media, where you have instant communication, decision-making need to be much quicker. And so he uses that a lot in terms of getting the best out from people that they communicate instantly. Diversity, he also put that as a core on the pedestal to the principles on people management as far as they're concerned, getting more women involved, more diverse ways of thinking, and to make the business thrive. So on those three, the pillars or the triangle on entrepreneurship, lots of lessons learned on transformation, lots of lessons learned on people management, lots of lessons learned. At the core part of the triangle, it's about focus, the business focus and the things that you have within you. You know, the core part, what's within you, looking at yourself in the mirror, learning how to improve yourself. You know, those kinds of being very, very focused and looking at customers, those are very internal things that happen to an individual. So there's a lot of lessons learned, Tony. My guys, I think they've taken copious notes, and thank you very much for spending today with us. And it's a really great pleasure. And I'm sure your business will thrive, particularly the airlines, after it is all, the dust is settled. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Idris. It was a lot of fun. And thank you to all your guys who interviewed me and questioned me and stuff. I had a lot of fun. Fizman. And one day, Idris will take us for a beer. Well, you may not have a beer. But you can have a drink with Tony and Dato Sri Idris Jala.
Yeah, sure.
You see, you call Idris, so get used to it. Cool. Sure. I mean, that goes back just the very last lesson. Titles are really nice to have, and I have nothing wrong with them, but they add a little bit of complexity to your structure. Keep things simple. And, you know, I dress down at AirAsia because if I look worse than my staff, then they never feel afraid to talk to me. If I wear a suit and a tie, you put a distance between your staff. Sure. So, Fizman, you did a fantastic job. Congratulations. And when you finish with PEMANDU, come work for AirAsia.
Hey, don't go there. Don't go there. Hey, on a serious note, Tony, I mean, since Roland is here with us, we have a very nice tavern or a pub at our brewery. We should invite you and a couple of you guys to come and join us there.
Please do. And let's have that jam session we never had.
Yeah. The jam, the instruments are all there, all waiting.
Okay. Done.
Okay, man.
All right. Done. Take care. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Thanks, Dr. Idris, for wrapping it all up. And again, he's not here, but thanks to Tony for sharing his wisdom and insights with us today. A huge thank you also goes out to our audience for joining us. The Brown Bag Series by PEMANDU Associates will be organized on a regular basis with great speakers lined up for all of you, such as Tan Sri Azwan Mota, Tan Sri Wahid Omar, and Dato' Yvonne Chia. So stay connected with us on social media where you can get the latest updates on the Brown Bag Series. You can scan the QR code and it will direct you to all of our social media accounts. We look forward to seeing all of you again in the next session. Until then, stay safe, stay well, and have a good weekend. Bye.